For the therapeutic purposes, you need to assess the physical strength of the patient, and therefore, based on the arthropathies, can be two types. And so far as sadhya sadhyata is concerned, it's a sadhya, karcha sadhya, yapya, asadhya, arishta lakshana, and different categories are possible in this particular way also. Or if you consider the eka dosha as a variety of prameha, it's considered to be apparition care in the literature. This is about just the different varieties of work, prameha roga, based on the different the aspects of the disease. And which particular dosha is involved? Definitely all the three dosha is involved in 20 varieties. In the Shleshma Prathamam Prakopam, and it is the same Shleshma dosha that gets involved first in the Samprapti. Bahudravaha Shleshma dosha vishesha, and is it the Shleshma as a whole? One further he says that it is the liquid quality of that, fluid quality of that particular Shleshma dosha is predominantly affected. Gunati Yoga Vrdhattvam, and its properties of the Kapha dosha is also included. Ati Pramana Vrdhattvam, its quality is increased, its quantity is also increased. Sarvai Reva Gunai Vikrutattvam, and all the properties of the Kapha guna is said to be affected. Sarvadeha Gata Vyana Kartattva, and the illness involves the whole body. Though the symptom presentation is of frequent passing of the urine, the illness is characterized by involvement of the whole body, as the Vyanada Vayu is involved, and Metatvara Samchita Apana Vayu as the final presentation is concerned. And this is about the doshic involvement. Future involvement is also very specific. Trayanam api doshanam shleshma prameshya praka prakopam apadyate tada shleshma dikshaya pittam prabali bhavet chunitam api dushvet. Tatkshaya api vayu vasadin dhatum sharirasa prama sarabhutan bastim akrisha mutrena saha visajati. And it is being said that the kapha dosha is involved, pitta dosha is involved, vata dosha is involved, and when the kapha dosha is involved, it is actually the initial phase of prameha, that is kapha prameha. And when the involvement of pitta is with pitta and shonita happens, then that is considered with pitta prameha. And lastly, because of the dhatu kshaya, there will be involvement of the vata dosha, that presents with vata prameha. This is how the unique course of the illness is about. Dushya, there are two aspects related to dushya. One is dhatu is increased, dhatu bahutpatha. And second is dhatu abaddhata. These are the two phenomena that is involved in the dushya of prameha roga. And it is margaga, that means it has to be, poshaka has to reach into the final dhatu. And it is dhatu is not yet to be formed. And so for agara dhatu is concerned, if it has to be circulating, then it should be in the liquid form or fluid form. And therefore it is uncondensed. So the abaddha dushya in case of prameha refers to asammata agana margaga asthayi poshaka dhatu. And such is the characteristic feature of abaddha dushya. Bahutva and abaddha, and in that abaddha dushya is applicable to which one? Bahutva is definitely the abaddha dushya. Medhas. Medhas, when it is baddha, that is deposited, then is abaddha, which is circulating. And in the literature, it's also referred as shonita abhichana in some other literature, and it is also called as amarasa in Charaka Samhita, in Sushruta Samhita, in the context of Stavya. So that is abaddhatva of dushya. And mamsa sneha when it is circulating, that is abaddhatva. Vasa, when it is circulating, it is called abaddhatva. Majja, sneha. So it's actually the sneha which is being circulating is considered as abaddha dushya. And abaddhata is medhas, mamsa, vasa, majja. And why this particular specification is required? Because there is another category of dushya which is involved, that is only bahutva, that is not abaddhatva, because they have the liquid form themselves. So when the rasa is concerned, it is bahutva. It cannot be called as abaddhatva, because abaddhatva is the basic characteristic features. It's not a morbid pathology, rather it's a natural phenomena. Lasika, it is bahutva dushya. Rakta is bahutva dushya. Shukra is bahutva dushya. Ambu is bahutva dushya. Aparavaja is bahutva dushya. So bahutva and abaddhatva is the two characteristic features. And the bahutva and abaddhatva is both applicable to medhas, mamsa, vasa and majja. And bahutva, only bahutva is applicable to the rasa, lasika, rakta, shukra, ambu and aparavaja. स्वाबद्धम इति असम्मतम अर्थात बहुत्वम अगंतुम च यथा योग्यतया बोधव्यम नॉट दैट एवरी धातु विल हैव दी बट बहुत्व एंड अबद्धम तेन मेधिस मांस वसा मन्योश्च द्वयम अपि सो मेध मांस वसा मन्य लेट बी दी बहुत्व एंड अबद्धत इज सेम शेषेषु रस रसिक रस लसिक रक्त शुक्र अम्बु एंड अपरोज दीज हैव बहुत्व ओनली दी बहुत्व बिकॉज अबद्धता रेपस लिक्विडिटी दीज बॉडी एलिमेंट्स आर liquid dhatu and therefore that particular quality remains but only the bahutva is the pathological feature. One should remember something about the avasham bhavi dashadushya and dashadushya is mentioned and tridosha is mentioned in that and all the dushya that are mentioned in the literature should they be involved in all varieties of the prameha in 20 varieties of prameha or in 20 varieties of prameha some dushya is involved in some and another some dushya is involved in some is it the category. The literature says that there is category known as avashyambhavi dushya. That means rasasya ojasiti rasaujaham ojasopi madhumeha dushyatva yadyapi medha prabhutya dushya uttyate tatapi medho mamsam shariram kledanam avashyambhavitaya parigraha. Whatever may be the type of the prameha, these medha mamsa sharira kleda, these are invariably involved. Exclusively may be involved or may not be involved. And their involvement is very specific in specific variety of the prameha. So avashyambhavikataya parigraha means medha mamsa sharira kleda majjadesha sarvamena punaravasham dushyante and majja and the other dhatu that is listed they may not be present in all varieties. They are present in only some varieties. Stokam adushtim bhavati or you say that they are also involved. Their involvement is insignificant, that is very minute and insignificant, but medha mamsa sharira kleda is concerned. These are invariably involved in all varieties of the prameha and therefore it is called as avashyam bhavi dushya and the remaining is stokam va dushtam bhavati or punaha avashyam dushna punaha avashyam dushyante kim va samyane dushyatvam tada sakala dushyatvam these are actually the difference. So this particular consideration avashyam bhavi dasha dushya, this particular understanding is quite essential for differential diagnosis of different varieties of the prameha. When I consider this in terms of vataja pitaja kapala prameha and avashyam bhavi dushya in case of the shleshma prameha is rasa mamsa vidha shukra and kleda, these are essentially involved in one or the other varieties of the kapala prameha. And so far as the pitaja prameha is concerned where shunita, so rasa mamsa kleda, this is common and shunita may be additionally involved so far as this part of pitta prameha is concerned. This is characteristic which is missing of prameha and vata. And so for the vata prameha is concerned, vasa majja rasika and mojas, these are considered to be the avashyam bhavi dushya. So the dushya is mentioned in the literature as in common for all the varieties, but in that also some are very specific to the vata shleshmata pitta and vata prameha. Tatra shleshmana prameha dushya medho mamsa kleda rasa shukrani pittasya tani sarvani tatha shunitam cha pittasya sarvani tatha chunitam cha and vatasya vasa majja lasika ojasi. So this is about the avashyam bhavi dushya in vataja pitaja and kapaja variety and the identification of which based on the symptomatology is very helpful in differentiating the 20 varieties of the prameha. And further, so far as the sweetness is concerned, shleshma pittam cha medasya mamsacha adi pravartate vayu tai avartana gati ojam adaya. So the ojas involvement is said to be the typical so far as the prameha is concerned and ojas is sarpir varnam madarasam rajagandhi. It's not the para ojas, rather it is the apara ojas which has got the color of the sarpe which is sweet in taste and that has got the rajagandhi or the smell of the cereals. So this particular ojas is involved yada bastim gatada kurcho madumeha pravartate then the patient will have. And further, shleshma pittam cha medasya mamsam chaadi pravartate tayara avrita gadir vayu ojam adaya gacchati yada abhastim tada kurchura madhumeha pravati. That it has been said that how the madhumeha happens and the ojas and therefore sweetness is likely because ojas is concerned with sweet. And another factor is that is related to that of the sweetness of the urine. And how about the sweetness of the body tanu madhurya? That is a sarva eva prameha yasma dehe deham madhurya krite jayante tasmat madhumeha ityuchyante. In all the varieties of prameha, 20 varieties of the prameha, there is sweetness of the body and therefore it is considered to be the madhumeha. Vachanami shatpada pipilika bicha sharira mutra abhisaranam iti shatpada pipilika these are likely to be moving in all 20 varieties. Tathacha vagbada madhuram yachu sarveshu prayo madhumehadi sarvayeva madhumehadya madhuryachatanuraga. Since the sweetness of the body is present in all the 20 varieties, all the 20 varieties of Pramaya is considered to be the Madhumeha. Or to say, sweetness of the body is a characteristic feature of the Pramaya in all varieties. And sweetness may be present also in the urine. And why sweetness may be present also in the urine? You have this particular classification that says that urine, taste of the urine that may vary in case of the Pramaya, that includes Madhura rasa, Amla rasa, Lavana rasa, Katra rasa, Kshara rasa and Kashaya rasa. And maximum number, that is 3, 6 and 9 and 10. 10 have these sweet tastes in the urine. And you know, Neelameha and Kalameha, where the taste of the urine is Amla rasa, it is sour in taste. But so far as the urine in case of the Lohitameha is concerned, that is a salt in taste. And Haridrameha and Manjishtameha, that has got the Katra rasa. And Charameha has got the Charases. And Vasa Madhya, Asthimeha and Madhumeha is concerned, where the taste of the urine is considered to Kashaya rasa. So, Tanu Madhure is common for all rasa. And in that also it is said that Santana Anubandhitva, it runs in families. And it is being said that Matra Pitra Bija Doshakrata. And this particular abnormality of the seed is concerned, that may be derived from the father or mother, both is possible. And further, Pitra Pitamahadi Karano Buddha. And so far as the inheritance is concerned, inheritance is from parents and grandparents. That's about the inheritance of this particular disease that runs in the family. And Prameha Arambaka Dosha Dushti Bijaja. And the abnormality is Prameha Arambaka Dosha related abnormality is present in the Bija, and that itself runs in the families. And runs in the family in the sense from generation to generation, that is Pitra Pitamahadi Karano Buddha. So in this particular way, it will be running in these different the generations. That's about the Sahaja and Apadhyana Mitraja. And to be more clear about the Sahaja and Apadhyana Mitraja, Sahaja Pramehi likely to have lean and thin body, rather Apadhyana Mitraja likely to have the heavy body. And so far as the body parts are concerned, they exhibit dryness, but so far as Apadhyana Mitraja, they exhibit the unctuousness. And so far as the food consumption is concerned, the Sahaja Pramehi likely to have less food, and so far as the Apadhyana Mitraja likely to have a tendency of taking more food. And so far as the thirst is concerned, Sahaja heavy thirst, and so far as the Apadhyana Mitraja likely to have less thirst. And so far as the body habit or physical habit is concerned, and the patient who is suffering from Sahaja Pramehi likely to be very active, but so far as the Apadhyana Mitraja Pramehi, he tend to be more comfortable in the sedentary life. So, Dau Pramoha Bodha Sahaja Apadhyana Mitraja, that's about the difference in the clinical presentation that will help you to differentiate these two. And so far as the Dhatu Kshayaja and Dosha Avrata Pataja is concerned, these are another two varieties. Dhatu Kshayaja is Apatarpanaja, because Apatarpana causes the Dhatu Kshaya, Dhatu Kshaya produces the Prameha. And so far as the Doshavrata Pataja is concerned, it is Santarpana. Santarpana causes the Kapha and Medhas, and the Kapha and Medhas that causes the Avarna, and therefore Doshavrata Pataja is Santarpanaja. And so far as the Dhatu Kshayaja is concerned, Dhatu Kshaya leads to Visheshana Vata Dosha, and therefore predominance of Vata Dosha is characteristic of the Dhatu Kshayaja variety. And so far as Kapha Sandhava, the features of Kapha is more likely, so far as the Avrata Pataja Prameha is concerned. Kshanath Kshanath Purno Bhajate. And so far as the progression of the disease is concerned, it is slowly progressive. But so far as the Margavaranaja is concerned, and in a short duration, it can manifest as a clinical symptomatological phase. And so far as the type 1 or the Dhatu Kshayaja is Sadhya, and so far as the Doshavrata Pataja is concerned, it is Karchasadhya. It has got a comparatively better prognosis when the prognosis is concerned, the Doshavrata Pataja has got a better prognosis comparison to the Dhatu Kshayaja. Drishtva Prameha Madhuram Sapecha Madhupam Syat Vido Vicharaha Kshineshu Dosheshu Anilatmaka Asyat Santarpanatva Kapasambhava Asyat. What the literature specifies, the same is being elaborated. The other classification based on the samprapti is Sapura Rupa and Apura Rupa. So for as the Pura Rupa of the Prameha is concerned, most of them are related to the Medhas. Therefore, when the Medhas is involved, predominantly involved, it will present with the Pura Rupa. When the Medhas is not involved, then it is Apura Rupa. So Sapura Rupa Kapapitta Meha Kramena Ye Vada Kritasya Meha Sadhyo Na Te Pitta Kritastu Syapya Sadhyastu Medho Yadi Na Pradushtam. So Medha Pradosha is the predominant Samprapti, but at the end he says that there are two categories. When Medha Yadi Pradushtam, Medho Yadi Na Pradushtam, that is Medho Pradushtam, Medho Na Pradushtam, then Sapura Rupa and Apura Rupa. So that is Sapura Rupa and Apura Rupa. Kafaja, more likely Sapura Rupa, and Kafaja is Asadhya, but Kafaja in the Apura Rupa, it may be Sadhya even. The progress also differs based on this. And this is about the Sapura Rupa Prameha and the Apura Rupa Prameha. And about the Sapura Rupa, Medha Dushti Apura Rupa is characteristic figure. Therefore, if the Medha is involved, then Pura Rupa is likely to have to present. Karapada Daha, Arasya, Maram Kaya, Kaya Chidresh Upadeham, Paridaham Suptada Changesha, Visram Charira Gandham, Nitra, Tandra, all these are the features of the Medhas. And therefore, Medhas, when it is involved, these are the Pura Rupa that will present in Prameha, and therefore, this is called as Sapura Rupa Prameha. And you have the, based on the Atrabala, this particular classification is very important for the treatment purposes. One is the Sula Prameha, the second one is the Krishna Prameha. And if the person is a Sula Prameha, he is considered to be physically strong, Balavan. And if the patient is a Krishna Prameha, then he is considered to be physically weak. And the physically strong, then Apatinvija, it's likely to be caused by the wrong dietary and behavioral activities. And so far as the Krishna Prameha is concerned, likely to be it's congenital or it's inherited. And so far as Sula Prameha is concerned, Samprapti is probably Margavanaja. And the second, the Dhatukshaya is Krishna Prameha. And in Stula Pramehi, Kapha is dominant. And in Krishna Pramehi, Vata is dominant. And Stula Pramehi is Sapura Rupa. And the Krishna Pramehi is likely to Apura Rupa. And Stula Pramehi, and it's likely to run a long course. And more importantly, Stula Balavan Apatimilji is best treated by the Chodana Chikitsa. And Krishna Paridurbala Sahaja is concerned, it is best treated by the Samana Chikitsa. So this is about the Atrabalena Devida Prameha, Sula Prameha, Krishna Prameha, likely to have the following characteristic features in Sula Prameha and the Krishna Prameha. And this particular classification will help you to decide the Shodhana Sadhya or Shamana Sadhya, which particular treatment has to be planned in these two varieties, where the other factors need to be considered for the same purpose. And Krishna Sadhya Kavaja and Margavanaja, Yapya Sahaja Kavaja and Pittaja Prameha, Asadhya. Yes, these are the varieties. When the Pidaka, Pidita and Sopadra is consumed by Asadhya, Arishta, Bala, Mamsa, Kshaya. Person is consuming food, Bala and Mamsa tend to continuously reduce. Swapne, Sneha, Pana, Gridnanti, Maksha. So that's about the Sadhya, Sadhya based on the Samakriya, Samsara, Dosha, Virudha, Upakrama and the Mahatheka factors. And Yeka Dosha, Prameha is considered Apari Sankhya. Whatever the text describes is this Sannipataja Prameha or Tridoshaja Prameha. Tridosha Nimittaha Prameha Vimshati. So Tridoshaja Prameha Vimshati Reva Bhavanti. Natu Prameha Vimshati Reva Bhavanti. Paratvara Yeka Doshajaya Prameha Vikara Aparisankeya Bhavanti. Therefore, if all the three dosha is not involved and still the dosha is a patient is presenting with Prameha, that's considered to be Yeka Dosha Prameha. That's likely to that's considered to be easily treatable. And Tridosha Prameha is difficult to treat. And Dosha Bhedina Trivida Prameha, Prameha Bhimshati Tatra, Shleshmadu Dosha, Pitta Dosha, Chatvara Anila, this is about based on the dominant dosha involved, the Prameha is considered to be the. And so far as the Pratyatmalinga is concerned, Prabhuta Mudra and Avila Mudra, this is considered to be Pratyatmalinga. But this particular Pratyatmalinga may not be present in all, in some. And in some diseases, it is Prabhuta is characteristic. In some, it is Prabhuta Avila Mudra. Udaka meha, Sandra meha, Sandra prasada meha, Shita meha, Shanair meha is concerned where the Prabhutada is very predominant. Ikshu meha, Shukla meha, Shukra meha, Sikra meha, where Prabhuta, Avila Mutada is prevalent. So, Prabhuta and Avila Mutada are the characteristic feature, and the Avilata may not be present in some variety. So, this is just the introduction to the subject Prameha. I never considered that this is a complete description, but this is just to brush up your memory so that the describing the treatment may be easy. So, with that particular intention, some points related to the Prameha is being discussed. Now, about the Chikitsa. And we considered as two categories of the patients. One is Shodhanara Prameha, the second is Brahmanara Prameha. And in one category of the patient where the Shodhana is indicated, and another the Shodhana is contraindicated. Whom you considered as the Shodhana is indicated. That is Kapha Pittaja Prameha. Kapha Pittaja Prameha is considered to be the Shodhana is indicated. In whom it is contraindicated, Vataja Prameha. And similarly, Ahita Ahara Viharaja Prameha, that is Apatya Nimittaja Prameha, is best treated by the Shodhana. But quite opposite to that, Sahaja Prameha is best treated by the Shodhana, not by the Shodhana. And Stula Prameha is treated by the Shodhana and not by the Krishna Prameha. And Sadhya and Yapya Raya Prameha is treated by the Shodhana Prameha, Shodhana treatment. And so the Asadhya Prameha is not treated by the Shodhana, rather preparatively the Shamana should be the case. And Dosha Dirke is present, then you go for the Shodhana. Alpa Dosha, if it is present, then you go for the Shamana Chikitsa. And Bala Dirke, if the patient is physically strong, then he is fit for Shodhana, and therefore you will do the Shodhana. And if the patient is lean and thin, then he is unfit for Shodhana. And therefore, one should restrict the Shamana treatment as Shodhana is contraindicated. And how about the Shodhana? And Shodhana, you can think about the Sampurna Shodhana. That means all five procedures that is applied in a patient of suffering from the Prameha. That is, as mentioned later, Sampurna Shodhana. And Sampurna Shodhana, if you are planning in any patient, that takes about 140 days. And the sequence is also mentioned in the literature. That means to begin with, it is the Vamana Karma, and then it is Vidyasana, and after that Vipassi, in that particular way you have to go, and then you have to go for Vilakta Moksha, in that particular way you have to go, then it is called Sampurna Shodhana. And it takes about, since it takes about 140 days, though this is considered to be very effective in case of the Prameha, practically you have a problem because of this particular 140 days. And therefore, this particular Sampurna Shodhana in patients suffering from the Prameha is more an academic topic rather than a practical topic, rather than a clinical topic. Because motivating the patient for 140 days of Shodhana treatment, that's very difficult. And therefore, you have the option of going for Bhumcha Shodhana. Of course, all five procedures are indicated, but in a given patient, some of them may be contraindicated. And when you avoid the contraindicated procedures in the patient, then you will be going for, you will not be planning Sampurna Shodhana, rather most of the Shodhana that may be planned with the due consideration of contraindications. That is considered Bhumcha Shodhana. And then comes the Punana Shodhana. This is another practice. You can think about the Sampurna Shodhana, but motivating the patient may be difficult. You can think about the Bhumcha Shodhana, that also the motivation of the patient is difficult. That means it may take about 80 to 100 days. Punana Shodhana is an ideal procedure where you will be repeating at regular interval. That means the patient is suffering from the Prameha. Every year, once in 6 months, you can plan the Shodhana treatment. So that the Shamana after the Shodhana may be very, very efficacious. This is repeatedly at regular or irregular intervals, depending upon the availability, depending upon the severity. And how frequently you can plan this called Puna Shodhana, that is mentioned in the Pushta chapter as one can plan, repeat the Vamana procedure in 15 days and Vidyasana in 30 days. The same, that is, means at the earliest. But depending upon the requirement, it may be late also. That means once in a year or twice in a year, you can plan the Shodhana procedure in patients suffering from the Prachaga. It is known as Puna Shodhana, an ideal way of planning, and it is also planned in many institutions. And most important is Kramatha Shodhana. Some Shodhana Ullekha Ranganani Kali Prayukta Kapha Prameha. And patient is suffering from illness. Morbid dosha is circulating in the whole body, and that need to be mobilized to the costa. And then it can be eliminated. And therefore, you have to plan Rukshana Chikitsa to begin with, Deepana Pachana to continue, followed by the Snayapana, and then the Snigdha Sveta. After that is Chodana, that is followed by the Samsara Janakarma. And in that particular day, you will be doing a sequential procedure that mobilizes dosha from the site of nature to the site of elimination, and then it is being eliminated either from the upper root or lower root. And this particular methodical administration of procedures is known as Kramata Shodhana. That is sequential procedure where the dosha is mobilized from periphery into the core and then it is being eliminated. And this is the ideal procedure. This is the ideal procedure that may be adopted in Pramaya, and this is also being adopted in most of the physicians. Most of the physicians follow this particular procedure, that is Kramata Shodhana. Single sitting of this particular Shodhana, that is either Vamana or Virechana, will take about 15 days. By that particular duration, the procedure is over. The same methodology may be used even for the Punashodhana. Repeatedly, you can do the same thing. An alternative is Nitya Shodhana, regular. This is also being adopted. If the patient is unable to go for the Kramata Shodhana for any reason, maybe comparatively physically weak, but the severity of the dosha is more, then you can think about the Nitya Shodhana. Like that of the year end of Taila is given in a small dose of 20 ml every day for about 15 to 30 days. Where instead of passing 30 loose stools in a single day, the patient passing the loose stools 3 per day means 30 numbers in 10 days, that itself is the Nitya Shodhana. That is an alternative. If the patient is unable to get a lenience from the profession, they cannot get a leave from the profession, and you want to continue the Shodhana at home, then you can think about this part of Nitya Shodhana. And its efficacy is maybe lesser than that of the Kramata Shodhana, but still it is efficacious. That is ideal to plan in patients who cannot get a leave and get admitted in the hospital, because Nitya Shodhana is possible even if the patient is not admitted to the hospital. And the patient can take this particular treatment at home. And also, the patient can continue with the profession, because the Nitya Shodhana Virechana is the most common one that is being practiced. And in that particular, Virechana Karma is concerned by the Eranda Thera. If you give it at 6 o'clock in the morning, by 9 o'clock, all activity of that particular Virechana is over. And after 9 o'clock onwards until the late evening, he is fit for the professional activities. Therefore, this is an ideal procedure. And Sandhya Shodhana, of course, it is not planned here so far as the Pramaya is concerned, because the dosha need to be mobilized. In any case, if the dosha is located in the Amashaya itself, by the disease process itself, then you can go for the Sandhya Shodhana. And Ubhaya Shodhana is another procedure that is being practiced so far as Panchakarma is concerned, where there are some of the drugs like that of the Devadali. When it is administered, it causes both vomiting and diarrhea together. That's known as Ubhaya Shodhana, that may be even planned. So that's about another procedure. But among these different practices, 7 practices of Shodhana procedure, that's Sampurna, Boshapana, Kramata, Nitya, and Sadhya, and Ubhaya Shodhana. Kramata Shodhana and Nitya Shodhana and Punaha Shodhana, this is most ideal to be practiced in a patient suffering from the Prameha. The remaining you can simply forget about. And further, Prameha Chikitsa, about the Kramata Shodhana, what need to be done? Rukshana is considered to be very mandatory. Rukshana and the Deepana Pachana and Snehana and Snigdha Sveta, these are the pre-operative procedures. Rukshana is avoided in most, but Deepana Pachana, Snehana and Snigdha Sveta is considered to be the mandatory. Where Rukshana is indicated, where the Medhas is involved, when the Snigdha in the body is present, when the person is overweight, then Rukshana is mandatory. And how will you get the Rukshana effect? That's by administering the Tripla Chuna in a dose of 6 grams thrice daily for about 7 days. By 7 days, the Rukshana of the body is said to be completed. Or you have the option of prescribing the Yavana in the foot for 7 days. That will also ensure the Rukshana in the body. So once the Rukshana is over, then you can go with the Deepana Pachana. So Deepana Pachana is Chitrakadivati 6 grams TID for maximum 7 days. And in case if you consider that the patient's physical or the digestive ability is optimal, then give it for a day or two or three, then you can go for the Snehana. And one should remember that Snehana is not ideal when the Medhas is involved, because Snehana is likely to be worsening the Medhas. And since the snehana is a snehapana is considered to be part and parcel of any shodhana procedure. It's also indicated in case of the prameha, where the specific taila like that of nikumbhati taila or the priyanga or the kurta, this can be utilized, this can be prescribed for the snehana purpose for the shodhananga, as shodhananga sneha. Snigdha sveda is indicated, and the application of the oil, so far as the application of the oil is concerned, it may be simply the lepa, or it may be the abhyanga, it may be the udvartana, or it may be the mardana, or it may be the padagata. Among these, udvartana is most ideal if the patient is overweight and obese. And so far as the udvartana is concerned, that is considered to be the two. One is snigdha udvartana and the second is ruksha udvartana. Udvartana is ideal for the as medohara, and snigdhata is required for the shodhana. And therefore, you can think about the snigdha udvartana rather than ruksha udvartana as shodhananga sveda, snigdha sveda. And after application of the oil in the form of the snigdha udvartana, one should go for the svedana. And the usual way of going for svedana is by the procedure of baspa sveda also. But in case of the prameha and also in case of the stavulya, agni sveda is usually contraindicated. And therefore, one can think about the anagni sveda. That means the patient is anointed with the oil by the method of snigdha udvartana. That is followed by he is asked to walk briskly on the sunshine. That will cause adequate sweating, and that's considered by anagni sveda. And this particular brisk walking is also considered by treatment of prameha. It's also additionally benefit. It also does the svedana, and additionally it's also a form of treatment. And therefore, there will be a dual effect. One can think about this particular snigdha udvartana followed by brisk walk to induce sweating. One can think about the vamana and virechana as a shodhana procedure, because these are the preoperative procedure that is indicated for vamana and virechana, and that should be followed by the samsajana krama of 7 days. You can opt the peyadi krama or tarpanadi krama. If the elimination of the dosha is adequate according to your calculation, then you think about the peyadi krama. And if the elimination of the dosha, if it is inadequate, if there is very little amount of the fluid loss, then instead of peyadi krama, you can go for the tarpanadi krama as the samsajana krama. That's about the planning of samshodhana chikitsa in case of the prameha. And further, rukshasya mihina vamana nishedat. In general, snehana is not ideal in prameha. But so far as shodhana is concerned, snehana should be given. Therefore, rukshasya mihina vamana nishedat. Without planning the snehana, the vamana should not be given in prameha. This is contraindicated. Tadatasya mihina balavatasya vamana mupadisha tatraita tailena anyatamena iti nikumbadi taila. And what about that particular taila which is being prescribed for the shodhananga sneha? It is not the non-medicated sneha, rather it is the medicated sneha. But therefore he says that tailena anyatamena iti nikumbadi tailana nikumba sarshapa atasi pichumarda or priyangvadi siddhena kritena in pittala. So about the shodhananga sneha pana, should you go for the medicated oil and ghee or non-medicated? This text specifies that you should go for the medicated one. And nikumbadi in taila, in case of the kafaja, and the girta in case of the pitta dominant varieties. That's about the selection of the oil. And in general, if the nikumba or the priyangva, the girta, if it is not available, as it is usually not available in the market, they are given a general principle. Gramya anubhavadaka mamsa guda dadi paya tilan pushti choti pramehi cha snehane na prayojayet. It is said that these are contraindicated. But he has also given an answer or an alternative. Snehaihi yatharthan tan siddhahi snehet abhikaribihi. And if the snehana is indicated in these diseases, then pippalibi haridakya siddhahi trivalayabhi. You can think about the processing the girdha with the pitta kapha-hara drugs like that, the pippali, haritaki, tripala, guguru and so on. And therefore, an alternative to the oil and the girdha, which is very specific for the prameha, if it is not available, you can think about the guguru girdha or panchadigdha guguru girdha as an alternative for snehana purpose. That's about the selection of the sneha for the samana. And then, sampurna shodhana is indicated in the text. Tatradidaya Pramehinam Snigdam Anyatamena Tailena Priyangvadi Siddhena Gritena Vamayet. First Vamana. And that is Prakadam Virechecha and then Virechana. विरेचनाद अनंतरम सुरसादि कषायन स्थापयेत महाऔषध भद्राद मुस्तव आवापेन मधुसैंद वैद्येन दह्यमानं च निग्रोधादि कषायेन निस्नेहेन. सो इट इज सुरसादि कषाय और भद्रदारु और मुस्ता और दे निग्रोधादि कषाय. This may be used for the asthapana purpose. And the vamana, virechana and asthapana, when it is completed, it is considered to be the sampurna shodhana, which is being indicated. One should remember about that. Snigdha sveda, pramehya, anagni sveda is indicated. Na chaitan katanchita api sveda yed, medo bahutva, diyate sham, vishirate deha svedena. And therefore, for the snigdha sveda, you think about the
Hello? Hello, doctor? Hello?
Medha Bhavatva Adhyayate. So, Anagnis Veda can be thought of instead of the Agnis Veda. Anagnis Veda in the form of a brisk walking or running. And Virechana also, it should be the Tikshna Virechana, Sampurna Shodhana and Virechana. Kapha Mehe Vamayet. Pitta Mehe Virechayet. Amashvese Kapha Pitte Vamayet. And Pakvashayaste Pitte Virechayet. The options of, that is available for them. And once again, Durvirecha hi madhumehino bhavanti. And therefore, Tikshnam yetesham shodhanam kurveta. And therefore, the dose of the medicine should be larger in case of the prameha, because patient finds it difficult to evacuate the bowel with the minute medications. And so, as the basti is concerned, in general, anasthapya mehina, it is being said in the literature. Ya eva anasthapya ta eva anumasya hasyu namadvara pandro kamala pramehinam doshan utkrisha udaran karoti. And if you give the basti in case of the such patient like that, the prameha, that's likely to worse land in some of the complications, including the abdominal distension. But it is well said that virechananantram saptaradral paratah vata vidradi adho ಉಕ್ತೇನ ಸುರಸಾದಿ ಕಷಾಯಣ ಮಾಂಶಧ ಆದಿ ಕಲ್ಕಯುಕ್ತೇನ ಮಧುಪ್ರಾಯಣ ದಹ್ಯಮಾನ ನೆಗ್ರೋಧಾದಿ ಕಷಾಯಣ ಆಸ್ಥಾಪಯೇತ್ ನಿಸ್ತೈಲೇನ ಇದು ವಚನ ಅಲ್ಪಗ್ರತಾಭ್ಯಾಮ್. ಸೊ ಫಾರ್ ಆಸ್ ದಿ ಆಯಿಲ್ ವಿಚ್ ಈಸ್ ಬೀಂಗ್ ಆಡೆಡ್, ಸೊ ಇನ್ ವೇರ್ ಎವರ್ ದಿ ವಾತ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರೆಸೆಂಟ್ ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಆಡ್ ಮೋರ್ ಆಯಿಲ್ ಟು ದಿ ಬಸ್ತಿ. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಬೀಂಗ್ ಸೆಟ್ ದಟ್ ದಿ ಪ್ರಪೋರ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ಆಯಿಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಮೋರ್ ಇನ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿ ವಾತ ಡಿಸ್ ಆರ್ಡರ್. ಬಟ್ ಸೊ ಫಾರ್ ದಿ ಪ್ರಮೇನ್ ಇಸ್ ಕನ್ಸರ್ನ್, ಈವನ್ ದೋ ದಿ ವಾತ ಈಸ್ ಪ್ರಿಡಾಮಿನೆಂಟ್, you are supposed to add little sneha, because it itself is the basic pathology which is involved. So since the astha ana basti is contraindicated in general, if the patient cannot be treated with the vamana and virechana, and still you consider that the shodhana is mandatory required, then you can think about the asthapana. Otherwise, in general, asthapana is contraindicated, and if you are planning asthapana, there is every possibility of the complication, and giving an eye or concentrating on that particular complication, you can plan the basti. Shodhana is the objective vatya pramaya indication. You can think about the karma basti, kala basti or yoga basti, and it is best administered in the madhyana tritiya prayare, somewhere around 12 to 3 p.m. nati bubhikshasya. And the dosage is 1,152 ml to 576. 768 ml is the most ideal dosage of basti, asthapana basti. Asthapana basti, nyagrodhati kashaya, mustadi niryuha, whatever the your prescription that can be given. And small amount of oil or rikrita ashwad, that is nikumbhadithai or priyangbhadikrita. And parihara, double the duration. That means if it is a yoga basti, the double the duration of yoga basti, kala basti, double the duration of 30 days, that should be the parihara kala. And consider, remember that, na brahmaniyan vidadita basti ni vishodhaniyeshu gadeshu vaitya, kushta prameha adishu medureshu. In patients who are suffering from prameha and the medras, you should not give the brahmana basti, because it is totally contraindicated. And therefore, shodhana, shamana, brahmana, rasayana are the objectives of, are the objectives of the basti. Among that, shodhana objective is considered so far as the prameha is concerned. Therefore, it is the last option if all the other possible shodhana is contraindicated and shodhana is mandatory. Then only you can think about that. After the shodhana, then you have to think about the tarpana. Or if the patient is not being treated with the shodhana, then you should think about the tarpana. tarpana is related with santarpana. Santarpana and tarpana is being used, is being considered as a major treatment. And tarpana does not mean that. Tarpana in case of the jwara, tarpana in case of the raktapitta, tarpana in case of the raja yakshma, tarpana in case of urakshata, that is different, and tarpana in case of the prameha is different. And how about the tarpana in the prameha? That's about the nutrition in case of the inpatient suffering from the prameha. How about trinadhanya mannam yava pradhanastu bhavet prameha? The patient is allowed to take the shastika shali, patient is allowed to take trinadhanya or the millets, or the patient is preferred to eat the yava. This should be the major content of the food. This should be the, or millets, millets and the yava, and this should be the major one. And further, Yavasya Bhaksha Vidam, where he says that Nishisthitanam Trifala Kashaya. How about this particular, the Trinadhanya or the Yava is concerned, that is also being processed. How will you process that? The processing of that is, these grains are being soaked in Trifala Kashaya overnight, and then it is collected and then it is being eaten. And when the Trinadhanya or Yava Pradhana, that is also being treated, when it is taken, that is considered to be the Shodhanottara Tarpana, or Tarpana in general, even if the Shodhana is not done. This should be the feeding. And further, the probiotic grains are also mentioned. That means Yava, the cow is being asked, cow is being allowed to take Yava along with its food. And in the dung, you are supposed to separate the Yava. That particular Yava should be used for the food. That's considered probiotic grains. And this is the use of these is considered to be the tarpana. So this is the unique tarpana, where the body is being filled with the body is being given adequate amount of food but less nutritious food. That's about this particular principle, so that stomach is filled but the supplementation of the sugar is minimized, so that it will maintain the sugar level. That's about the unique tarpana that is being mentioned. Since the patient is suffering from prameha, where the margavarna is common and that may involve the lower limbs, and therefore adequate protection of the lower limbs should be made in patients suffering from the prameha. That is because it is being said that tato madhumeha na urdhvam uddishta pramehanam doshaha tato madhumehanam adakkaye pidakaha pradurbhavanti. The major complications in the legs, and therefore one should consider the protection of the legs in patients suffering from the prameha. Little bit deviation from that, the Sushruta has given the treatment of prameha in terms of the stages. When the Purrupa is present, you have to think about the Apatarpana Kashaya and the Bastamutta. And if that particular stage is passed, then you can think about the Upayataha Samshodhanam. That means Avastham Sarachisa Mutram Shedrashesh Madhuri Bhavati Prayashta Abhivakta Bhavati. When there is a presentation of the prameha is present, then you have to go for the Samshodhana. Even if the treatment is not done, then there will be the production of the pidaka. And if that is the case, then you have to think about the shodhana of that. You know. And if the Shastra Pranidhana may be required, if the pakva or paka of the show, the Madhumeha Pidaka happens, and if it is further increased, then it is considered to be the asadhya. Therefore, stage wise treatment is also considered. Another is Stauri Chikitsa that can be done. Santorpanatya Shukadeshi Yoga Medasunam Yachamayo Padishta. All the treatment that is mentioned in for the Staulya, that can also be given in case of the prameha, that is additional benefit. Vaiparimandana Chikitsa is also required, and that's like about the Udvartana Chikitsa, and the patient is likely to have the features of the Staulya, and that is that precipitates the prameha pitaka, and therefore external treatment should be given enough importance so that the body is maintained clean. And in the food, Yava Pradhana and Trinadhanya, the Siridhanya or the Yava Pradhana Ahara, that should be given to the patient. And then Vyayama, that are also being given very much importance in case of the Prameha. And Chankravana is the best way of Vyayama, and it is said that it is 7.2 into 100 kilometers. That's about 720 kilometers is being advised for the patient at a stretch. You know, that doesn't mean that in a day patient will be able, person will be able to complete that much of exercise, but every exercise is needed that to treat the Prameha, that is being specified. And all the etiological factors that is mentioned, that is also should be avoided. That is Nirvana Thagi is also principle of treatment. And so far as Shamana is concerned, selection of that is most important. And you have the Saptarangi, Mesha Sringi, Jambu, Trivanga Shilajitu, Shatavari Bala, Sariva, Aritaki, Tripala, Guggulu, Shalashuna, Laksha, Chakramarda are the major drugs that are being used. Saptarangi, Mesha Sringi and Jambu is considered to be very effective in reducing the blood sugar also, and is effective in Prameha. And this is when the sugar is somewhere around 200-250, you can think about this in full doses. And if it doesn't respond to this, then you think about such formula that contains Trivanga and Shilajitu. Trivanga and Shilajitu. That means when it is around somewhere 250 to 300, you think about that. In that particular way, the dosage that remains, the dosage and the selection of the preparation that you use, that depends upon the severity of the illness accordingly you are supposed to think about. If the patient has burning sensation in the feet and loss of sensation in the feet, that is a peripheral neuropathy has happened, then Shatavari and the Bala should be the additional prescription that should be included so that the less symptoms are also controlled. If the patient has the frequent urinary tract infection that is also seen in patients suffering from the diabetes mellitus, and sometimes it may be totally asymptomatic but only the pus cells are same, that is being best treated by Sariva. If the patient has the atherosclerosis or ischemic limb disease or the diabetic foot phenomena, Aritaki and Tripala are the better additional treatment that can be given to the patient. Dyslipidemia, when it is present, you have many prescriptions. In that, Guggulu and Lashuna is most convenient. And if the patient has the diabetic foot with the bone density has reduced, think about adding Laksha to the prescription. And if the patient has the fungal infection that is developed in different parts of the body, secondary to this particular, the diabetes mellitus, it may be in the form of balanoprostatitis. It may be in the form of the fungal infection between the fingers, that is intertriginous intertrigo, or the patient may have the fungal infection on the groin region. These are all considered to be very common when the patient is heavy and also the diabetes is prominent. That can be treated with the Chakramarda. Shala Saradhya and Asaradhya Ganakvata, that is considered to be very effective, that can be prescribed to the patient in a dose of 90 ml size daily. Madhvasava and Rodrasava, the aso preparations, less frequently being prescribed. Devadharvadhya Arishta, that's also being frequently prescribed, that's about 90 ml TID is the dosage. Shala Saradhi Leha, that's being given in a dose of 200 mg, 250 mg thrice daily, in a very effective prescription. Chandra Prabhavati in a dose of 500 mg TID is also effective. Vasanta Kusuma Kararasa, 250 mg twice daily, which is good preparation, that's also equally effective. Vangeshwara mainly contains the Vanga as the ingredient, that's also equally effective. And so for the Shilajitu in any form, even the Lashuna in the form of Shilajitu Loha Rasayana or the Shilajitu Rasayana or the Shala Saradhi Bhavita Shilajitu, that's considered to be very effective. And depending upon the requirement, you can have the one or two drugs from this. That means one from the Asva Arishta or Arishta, the second from the Vati. In that particular way, you can go for the combination, or you can think about whole of presentation of that accordingly, you can plan the treatment. To sum up, Dvivida Prameha we have seen, Trivida we have seen, Vimshadi Prameha, that's based on the symptoms. And Medho Drishti, is it involved or not in the Puru Rupa, that involved or not involved, accordingly that is the presence or absence of Puru Rupa. Sthula Prameha and Krusha Prameha is a basic classification that's essential for the treatment. Prabhuta and Abhilamutra is considered to be the Pratyatmalinga, and some it is Prabhuta alone and some others Prabhuta and Abhilamutra both are seen. Samshodhana is mandatory if the patient is physically strong and if the excessive vishesana of dosha is present. Sampurna Shodhana, Kramata Shodhana are the different options. Kramata Shodhana is the most practiced and effective and easy to administer. Though Asthapana is contraindicated, at times you can think about the prescribing the Bhasta also. In general, Kapha Pitta Hara Sneha has to be considered for the purpose of Snehapana and Anagni Sveda for the Svedana as part and parcel of a Shodhana procedure. Yava Pradhana Ahara should be given in the form of Santarpana or the Tarpana, and at the same time, physical exercise is very supportive to the treatment. Saptarangi and the Shilajito are the main drugs that can be prescribed in cases of the Prameha. So this is about the, in short, the treatment of a Prameha. If you have any questions, you are most welcome.
Hello, Acharya sir has given a very meaningful and very important lecture. I am very much thankful to Acharya sir. He has basically elaborated the concept of Prameha and Madhumeha. Later on, he has put light on this Avashya Bhavi Dushya and its role in differential diagnosis as per a
So I'm extremely sorry for the initial inconvenience of audibility and also the screen sharing issue.
Okay, sir, let's continue on, sir. ನಿಮ್ದು 1+3 ಗೆ 2 ಲಕ್ಷಕ್ಕೆ 16,987.
ಇಲ್ಲ, ಮಧ್ಯಾಹ್ನ ಮಾತಾಡಿ. ಮಧ್ಯಾಹ್ನ ಮಾತಾಡಿ. ಮುಗಿಲಿಲ್ಲ.
ಹಲೋ
ಹಲೋ
ಯೆಸ್ 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 ಪ್ಲೀಸ್ ಫಾರ್ ಟ್ರೀಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಪರ್ಪಸ್ Just a minute, please let me conclude. For treatment purpose, for treatment purpose, he has given the different options where the patients are chosen are here, where a branch chikisa can be given. The most practical move, nitya shodhan at home can be done. Later on, chaman chikisa, patya patya, vayam, putra of prameha, nidhan parilayam chikisa. And return chikisa, everything has elaborated. Hope this lecture will help us a lot in the management of Prameha and Madhumeha patients. Acharya sir, there are a few questions. Please note. Acharya sir.
Yes.
There are a few questions. Please guide us. One has asked, in present scenario, the Madhumeha and diabetes mellitus, how it can be correlated? The second question here has been asked, the patients are with high blood sugar levels and the patients are taking number of medicines at present. So what to do in this situation?
Patient has high blood sugar and then?
They are taking number of medicines, for example, oral hypoglycemic agents. Oral hypoglycemic agents, then insulin-like drugs or number of drugs they are taking. So in this scenario, what to do? And the last question, as you have explained in your lecture about rasayan chikitsa, and whether ozuvardhan chikitsa as in madhumeha, how it can be given. There are a few questions the audience have asked. Please guide us, sir.
Anyway, again, it is your audibility is very minimum. And whatever I have understood, I shall answer.
Yeah.
The patient who are suffering from the diabetes mellitus with high sugar levels and who are already on medication, and people who are not on medication, they will come to us. The patient who are being recently diagnosed with diabetes mellitus and the level may be 300 or 400, but immediately when you start your medication and also start the diabetes sequence, immediately it will come to control to about 120 to 130. That's because in the initial phase, and it is excessive, the thirst and the excessive appetite that worsens the diabetes mellitus. And for the same reason, the patient will have the 300 to 350. And that is the first reduction. And when you immediately restrict them, 50% is corrected by the restricting, and 50% is by the medication. That means that will come to 120 or 130 at the earliest. There are patients who are already taking allopathy medicine and still they have about 300. Definitely you can think about these medications, adding these medications. And well, if the medications are not working, then you have the option of thinking about samshodhana. Samshodhana may be very essential in that. So if the patient is not at all fit for the samshodhana, then think about considering the diet, the yava pradana ahara. So you see that what the patient is taking. Then you change the diet. If the patient is taking the food two or three times a day, at least 1 to 2 times of the food should be changed to yava or the millets. And when it is changed, immediately the sugar level also can come down. In some occasion, it so happens that the sugar level does not come at all, come down at all. Then you think about the rasayana prabhin, that is about the chilajital over rasayana. That's very effective in working, effective in reducing the margavarna also. And therefore, it will work on margavarna and it also work on sugar. And therefore, chilajital over rasayana, for a short course of 30 days of chilajital over rasayana, followed by the shamana medication may be effective.
Yes, sir. Very thank you for this. Then there are a few other questions. Sir, what are the contraindications of neurobasti as far as Premeh is concerned?